across Wisconsin from Civic Media. This is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Thank you, Don Ruho. Hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. It's 6:06 on this Thursday, January 11th. Another beautiful day to have you here up north, live from Lake Wissota, from wherever you're listening across the Civic Media Radio Network, through the Civic Media app, through our social media video feeds, or maybe you're listening later in the day on demand by podcast. If so, thank you for subscribing and taking us along on your day. I've got a question for you. It's rather niche, so it doesn't apply to all of you, but I know there's going to be one or two of you that go, oh, yeah. Here's the question. Have you paid your property taxes yet? I was cleaning my desk early this morning and moving some papers around, and tucked in there was the property tax bill. It wasn't in the bill pile like it should have been. It was sitting in this other group. I was like, oh yeah, that first half or the full thing is due by January 31st. So if that helped any one or two of you make sure you didn't miss your deadline, well, then you're welcome. If you have anything on your mind this morning, whether it's your tax bill or things in the news or the weather, you can reach us this morning at 844-967-2789. You can call that number. You can text that number. You can do the same thing through the Civic Media app. And you can also email us, radio@upnorthnewswi.com, or you can leave a comment on one of the Facebook pages where you see the live video feed of this radio show. We'd like to have you along that way as well. Normally on Thursdays, we talk to our friend Joe Zepecki. He's a little under the weather, but did find us a fantastic substitute. Joe often talks about the group Protect Our Care, a healthcare advocacy organization. Well, since he couldn't make it, he found us the chair of Protect Our Care. And so Leslie Dock will join us at the bottom of the hour to ask a rather basic question. What kind of person still wakes up every day and makes it their mission to rip healthcare coverage away from millions of Americans? You know, things like free cancer screenings, lower prescription drug prices. Honestly, who's still doing this? Leslie Dock will tell you, since that's a big part of his job, because the threats to Americans' healthcare security is still very much alive and well and could yet succeed. In our second hour, Kristen Lyerly joins us for a segment about women winning Wisconsin, lifting up some of the women who are leaders in their community or candidates. Emily Cephos is one of those candidates for assembly, and we will visit with her. We will talk about the glamorous life of being a candidate, which in the social media age means not so glamorous. You shoot videos and give updates to the voters whenever you can, and that even includes the middle of a winter storm, as Emily had to do earlier this week. Civic Media meteorologist Brittany Merlot will have our forecast as we head into the weekend. There's snow, there's really cold temperatures on the way, so do pay attention about an hour from now when Britt is telling us all about that. I can tell you the temperatures right now across the Civic Media landscape. Get your little Civic Media map out. You can find it on the website, civicmedia.us. And we'll basically go left to right, top to bottom here. Once we tell you that here on Lake Wissota, it's 27 degrees. Hayward's at 26, Park Falls 19. Wausau reporting 26 degrees and Green Bay 27. Then La Crosse is at 24, Wisconsin Rapids 24, Oshkosh 28 degrees right now. Madison's at 26, and it is 28 degrees in Waukesha, where sitting in the Greg Bach chair is one Luke Mathers. With Greg gone on vacation, I think he left me a memo here of what to say. Now here's the very handsome and talented Luke Mathers, who I pray to God gives me a good job review. And did I mention he's handsome and talented? Okay, so I read that part from Greg. Good morning.
I wish that you made it sound like you didn't have to read it, though, Pat. You should have just had that part memorized. Come on. It was like two lines.
Yeah, that was a bridge too far for me. I can only do so much this early in the morning.
That's fair enough.
Especially with coffee that is a little more bitter. Let me take you right into old man chat for just a second here.
Let's do it. I miss old man chat. Let's get there.
Oh, goodness. Well, now, again, I had my annual physical last month, and so there's been a couple of follow-up things. You know, just we've talked about the poking and the prodding that, you know, accompanies a middle-aged man entering his elder years.
Uh-huh.
And so we switched up a particular medication. And he said, well, this is going to give you, you know, dry mouth and a couple of other things. And the dry mouth is very true. I've got this water bottle very close. But it's also kind of affected, you know, the taste of things. Mm-hmm. I'm making my coffee exactly the same way, but it's a little bit more bitter. And it just raises that question of whatever you have, if you pick any particular ailment or whatever, how far are you willing to go in terms of side effects, you know, in order to address that problem? Or at one point you go, oh, no, that's not worth it. I'd rather stay with the devil I know than take on the devil I don't. Welcome to healthcare in the 21st century, which, by the way, is still a great thing. You know, it used to be it's like you had some minor ailment, and it's like, well, we're going to have to cut your arm off, you know? So we
Dr. Pepper's not leeches. Yeah, I was about to say, Dr. Pepper's not forcing the leeches to go underneath your arm or something like that, at least.
Look, this is an age of miracles. It's just that sometimes it has, you know, little trade-offs that go along with it. And the property tax thing, I immediately thought I was being helpful to you. I thought you were a new homeowner within the past year here, but you've actually lived in beautiful sunny P for a little while now.
It's been a minute. We closed on the house back in December of 21, and we moved in February of 2022. So not quite 2 years in the house, but just over 2 years with the house purchased. So I already got that taken care of. It's on automatic payment. Make sure that I got it all covered that way.
Perfect.
Because I am like you, the bill sometimes just doesn't get to the right pile, and then I find it later. You clearly still pretty good about clearing up your piles in a reasonable timeline. Me, not so much. So
this one could have easily slipped past January 31st. And the fact of the matter is, nearly every regular bill is handled electronically. I've got it set up for automatic bill payment. I just have to review it, and everything's all fine. There was one particular company, and I don't want to list, you know, a local business, but there was one particular service that had not and would not for the longest time set up electronic bill payment, you know, through your bank.
Really?
They had to have a check. And so, and I would honestly just keep forgetting. And they would call and say, hey, we haven't received a payment from you. I'm like, yeah, because you're the only reason I still have a checkbook. You know, and I mean, eventually they adopted it, but it was just one of those things where
it took
it's like,
some time.
It took a little time. Again, the magic of home ownership. My other bit of magic of home ownership this week is to explain that there is a, I guess it's a sump. It's for a sump pump in the basement. There's a 40-gallon tank that's embedded in the basement floor. So it catches anything that comes from the basement bathroom, the basement sink, you know, the basement floor drains, and then pumps it up so it can get out to the septic system. Well, it's got a bench, you know, the equivalent of a manhole cover over it. It's about the size of a manhole cover for this, you know, maybe 12-inch deep tank. And I've noticed over the years that it's starting to get a little rusty. It's starting to get a little corroded, but, you know, didn't worry much about it. We're putting away the Christmas decorations, and by we, I mean Sherry. And I hear her call from the basement. It's like, is this supposed to be this way? And went down there and
you never
the cover
want to hear that. In home ownership, no. I've learned in the brief 2 years that I've been involved in it, you never want to ask yourself or hear the question asked, is this supposed to be that way?
Yes. Because the answer upon seeing that the cover had completely corroded through and you could now see inside the little 40-gallon pit, no. No, it's not supposed to look like that at all. And so, of course, I immediately had nightmares of, you know, when the water softener system kind of does this flush every, you know, couple of times a week, I just had visions of all this water draining out of it. So I had a plumber in yesterday. And, of course, you always get that first thing like, oh, it's not supposed to do that. Well, thank you, Sherlock. Yes, I agree. So hopefully
I know it's not working properly. That's why you're here. Yes. Like I've already diagnosed that part. Come on, like give me a little credit.
We have established this much, but thankfully it wasn't obstructing the pump itself. So it's still operating. It's just open air right now. It's like that Alaska Airlines check. Sometimes you just gotta have the open air version of what's going on.
There
so
you go.
Hopefully this new adventure in home ownership will have a nice ending to it in the very near future. Hey, if Mr. Mathers is here, you know we're going to be promoting civic media material. And I think tops on your list this week is to mention that Max Inc. Radio has something called Live in the Lair featuring a performance and interview with the Milwaukee-based original rock band Blame It on Kane, coming up 9 o'clock on Saturday.
Yeah.
This sounds exciting.
Yeah, so the Max Inc.
The whole Max Inc. radio thing sounds exciting.
You never know what you're going to tune in for. So it's a different show every single Saturday. It's excellent live local music. We unplug from everything else, and we play some tunes on Max Inc. across the Civic Media Network on Saturdays from 6 p.m. until midnight. And they are joined live in the Civic Media headquarters. They like to refer to it as the Lair. And the 9 p.m. hour of every Saturday evening.
So that's the Lair is the palatial Madison studio.
Correct. That's when they take over, it's no longer a studio. It's the Lair.
I like it. I like it very much. It's kind of like, you know, Man Cave or something else like that. So, well, good. Well, so be listening for that on Saturday. Quick look at sports now at 6:17. The Badger men's basketball team beat Ohio State last night, 71-60. Ohio State was still ahead with about 6 minutes left when the Badgers went on a 19-4 run. The Badgers have now won 11 of their past 12 games and go to 4-0. I believe they're the only undefeated team left in the Big Ten for men's basketball. The Marquette men's basketball team, which has been ranked 11th in the country this week, just lost again, fell to Butler last night at the Fiserv Forum, 69-62. The Badger women's basketball team lost at home to Northwestern last night, 74-69, dropping them to 1-4 in the Big Ten this season. The Marquette women's basketball team, ranked 23rd in the country, will host DePaul on Saturday. The Bucks are hosting the Boston Celtics tonight. That is at 6:30. And I believe if I push this little button, the people watching our live video feed will see that you can catch the Milwaukee Bucks games on Civic Media, on Oshkosh Air Support, on News from the Center and Richland Center, Lake Air and Amory, WRJN in Racine Kenosha, and 98Q Country in the Park Falls area. And last but not least, Packers Cowboys wildcard playoff football Sunday at 3:30 is the kickoff, but coverage starts at 1 o'clock Sunday afternoon on Radio from the Center, WRCO in Richland Center, also WRJN in Racine, and 98Q Country in Park Falls, your home for Packer football, playoff football against the Dallas Cowboys. We'll unpack some of the news coming up in a bit, wherever you're listening across Wisconsin on this beautiful Thursday morning, live from Lake Wissota. When you're here, you're up north. Back in just a bit. This is the 72nd birthday for jazz guitarist Lee Ritenour. This was his top 40 hit from 1981, Is It You?, which he co-wrote along with Bill Champlin and Eric Tagg, who sings lead. We'll have more birthdays and other notes in today's history lesson coming up in about a half hour or so here on Up North News Radio as we come up on 6:21 on this Thursday. Well, remember how for the longest time the joke, if you will, in politics could be summed up in three words: Democrats in disarray. It has so been a case of the shoe on the other foot for, well, basically the era of Trump, if you will, and it continues in the halls of Congress. You know, we talked to Congressman Mark Pocan yesterday on the program about Congress coming back into session, and there's still the looming threat of a government shutdown because they keep punting on budget deals that have already led to changes in speakership among House Republicans as they fight among themselves over whether they want to govern or whether they want to, you know, simply pose and shut the government down and appeal to their base. Well, the new Speaker, Mike Johnson, apparently, like his predecessors, understands, however briefly, that you need to govern. You need to get things done. That includes passing a budget, and that includes understanding you don't get to make all the rules. You have a Senate controlled by Democrats, a White House with a Democrat in it. You have watched all these other government showdowns, other government shutdowns, none of which led to Republicans winning. none of which led to Republicans getting the massive cuts they want to see in programs that Americans like. And so Mike Johnson appears to have struck a deal with Senate leaders as well to move forward on a spending bill. But of course, again, it doesn't go nearly far enough for the far right members of the House Republican delegation. And so, as noted by the New York Times copy here, it says, conservatives thrust the House back into chaos on Wednesday, grinding business to a halt in protest of the spending deal that Speaker Mike Johnson has struck with Democrats to avert a government shutdown and leaving the entire funding package in limbo. A dozen hardline Republicans defected from the party line to tank a routine procedural measure, blocking consideration of some Republican bills in what amounted to a warning shot filed by members of the far-right Freedom Caucus who are opposed to the agreement. And so, once again, you could see a case where just a handful of Republicans are going to force essentially a vote of no confidence in their own speaker. Again, even though there are plenty of Republicans, maybe plenty isn't the right word, but enough Republicans who want to again govern and work with Democrats and still come up with those win-wins. We're not talking about Republicans caving to everything that Democrats want. Democrats didn't get nearly everything they wanted the last time there was a deal between Kevin McCarthy and President Biden. But you can't negotiate something if you're refusing to budge at all. And that's where the far-right caucus is. But these are folks who are, they're sticking with Donald Trump, for example, no matter what. And by no matter what, is there any chance that you watched Donald Trump's town hall on Fox News? No, I'm guessing I have no takers as you're all listening in. But I'll tell you this much. He again refused to signal that he would give up ownership of his businesses if he were to return to the White House. That's despite new reports about the nearly $8 million he received from foreign governments during his first 2 years in office. Just his first 2 years alone, House Democrats were able to account for at least $8 million in foreign payments, something that was never allowed before Trump would, again, derail almost anybody else who abided by norms, traditions, you know, the law. And yet Trump was completely nonplussed about it, saying, well, I provide a service, talking about his hotels. And he did. He opened up this big fancy hotel near the White House, you know, at the start of his presidential term, took in all these foreign guests, foreign dignitaries, took their money, sold the hotel or closed it up shortly after he left office. It was an amazing grift. And basically, he'll do it again when he's not, you know, serving as dictator, as he again joked about being a dictator on day one. This is what Republicans are dealing with when they talk about the chaos that's in that party right now. They can't pass a budget. They have a fatally flawed presidential candidate right now. The people who were trying to steer the party back have been dropping like flies. Chris Christie dropped out yesterday. And while I take a sip of coffee here, I'm going to ask Luke whether he thinks Nikki Haley and Ron DeSantis can pose any kind of competition to Trump now.
Yeah, I did not watch either the Trump town hall nor the debate between Nikki Haley and Ron DeSantis. Again, as you alluded to, the Wisconsin Badgers were on, so I was watching the basketball game.
You chose correctly.
I chose wisely. I was a little nervous with they were playing behind Ohio State for a number of minutes throughout the game, and I got concerned. But you know, they eked out the win. But I did see a lot of clips from the events that took place in Iowa last night. And I don't understand how this isn't like just it's a fight for second, Pat. Like, it's just this weird aspect that they're still debating each other on stage with less than a week to go before the Iowa caucuses, all to see who's going to be the first loser, who's going to be runner up. Like, I don't get it.
Well, because, I mean, it seems so clear now that nobody is actually running against Trump. What they want is to be his running mate or to get a cabinet spot. And so they're trying to you know, have it both ways. They're trying to walk this very fine line of seeming tough enough to impress Trump, because of course Trump appreciates toughness as long as it's not against him, you know, and not wanting to upset him because they're convinced that he's going to be the nominee and that he might win. And again, emphasis on might. He might win. That's what happened in 2016 when he pulled it through in a squeaker. So we can't say that Trump can't win again. The polling shows us, you know, for now it remains close. But why they're all going through this, you know, political theater is beyond me, instead of actually getting some work done. But they know, as we've said repeatedly here, if they were to get some of the work done, they wouldn't have anything to campaign on. You still have Ron Johnson out there bragging about killing any deal for aid to Ukraine by killing any deal that would fix the crisis at the border. All of this is, it's a little frustrating as we get, but also a little bemusing, as you know, Mark Pocan talked to us about that yesterday. And you wonder, is there a way around this? Well, can we change the districts? Well, in Wisconsin, we're going to engage in redistricting, hopefully very soon. And in Wisconsin, we're going to talk later about a proposal called ranked choice voting and final five voting. But that too has Republicans in disarray as they fight amongst themselves over something, because it may actually break the stranglehold that both parties have on the voters' choices these days. So we'll try to touch on that before we get done. But coming up next, we've got Leslie Dock with Protect Our Care, pinch hitting for Joe Sopecki. Coming up next, live from Lake Wissota on the Civic Media Radio Network. This is Up North News Radio. We have made it to 6:34 on this Thursday morning on Up North News Radio, and normally we'd be talking to Joe Sopecki. Joe's got a bug. He's a little out of sorts this week. We were hoping to talk about some new information that had come out on behalf of Protect Our Care, a group that he works with to help defend and strengthen the Affordable Care Act. I guilted him about leaving me in a lurch, and talk about over-delivering. He has brought us this morning the board chair of Protect Our Care. Leslie Dock is with us today. Leslie, thank you so much for pinch hitting for Joe. It's nice to see you.
Yeah, it's tough shoes to fill, but great to meet you and great to be here and great to be with the people of Wisconsin.
I'm sure you won't have any problem here whatsoever, especially since we're going to get into some, you know, bad news or some potential threats to healthcare for Americans in a second. But let us start with some good news, and that would be the amount of people who have signed up for health insurance through the Affordable Care Act marketplace. There's been some very good news in the past day or so about that. Tell us about it.
Yeah, well, I'll start with the country as a whole. Over 20 million people have now signed up for coverage through the Affordable Care Act. And that's 20 million people who now have the peace of mind of affordable quality insurance to keep them healthy and to help them when they're sick. And, you know, we all know how important that is to every family every day, both by eliminating worry and also by keeping you healthy. So that was great news. None of that happens by accident. It happened because in the Inflation Reduction Act and in the family plan, financial assistance was extended and guaranteed and extended to more Americans, to the point now where 80% of people who buy their insurance on their own through the exchanges are paying less than $10 a month for the same insurance, you know, premium insurance. So that's great. But the news in Wisconsin is also great, because there were 254,000 Wisconsinites who have signed up for care. That is also a record number for the state. And importantly, and to all your listeners, we have 6 days left, or 5 days left for an open enrollment. And so people still have a chance. It goes until the 16th for people who haven't signed up to sign up. And for people who have a plan but may want to shop for a better plan, to go do that. And we've historically seen a surge at the end because we're all deadline-oriented people. But please, people will regret it if they don't take advantage of this, in a sense, bargain, the sale on something as important as health insurance.
And what's the best way for people who want to learn more about the marketplace to go to?
It's really just to go to healthcare.gov and go from there. And it's, you know, it's a lot easier than people think it is. And also people think that, you know, Obamacare or this is like some sort of sidebar insurance that's different. Really what the exchange is an opportunity to do shopping on plans that are offered by the brand name insurance companies. But they have to meet certain standards. And it's organized in a very simple way. So it really makes shopping easy.
And again, there are many people who have not yet been exposed to the marketplace for whatever reasons. They've had the good fortune not to have their careers disrupted or what have you. But it really is the case that people from all walks of life, not just, you know, lower incomes, but from all walks, who find themselves in between jobs or through other circumstances, they go to that marketplace and you hear them say, I did not realize you could actually take some of the complexity out of shopping for health insurance.
Yeah, without question. And it's, you know, it's not second class health insurance, it's first class health insurance. Well, I'm one of those people. When I was a senior counselor to the Secretary of Health and Human Services in the Obama administration, I left then to work on Hillary's campaign, and I was co-chairing the healthcare transition for Hillary. That didn't go so well. And so I found myself without health insurance. So I went right to the exchanges and bought myself health insurance. And, same. You know, it just completely worked.
Yeah, I had a similar circumstance myself, and you know, could not say enough about what a difference it is now compared to when we first started talking about this, you know, a couple of decades ago and more so. And yet, despite all the progress that we've made, the ease, the comfort that has been brought, the peace of mind that has been brought to more Americans, there are still no shortage of threats to that healthcare stability. Even here in 2024, there are Republicans primarily, almost exclusively, talking about tearing all of this down. And this week, you and Joe and others talked about at least three different threats that are still out there. Can you take us through those?
Yeah, there are a lot of people out there who are trying to pull down this law and pull out this insurance for people. And it's one of the things in the world you can't understand, really. You know, who wakes up in the morning? For example, one of these lawsuits, there are 150 million Americans who take advantage of free preventive services because of the Affordable Care Act. And so one thing that people also don't understand about the Affordable Care Act, I shouldn't say don't understand, don't know about it, is that it's not just about giving people affordable quality insurance. It guarantees protections for pre-existing conditions. It keeps your kids on your insurance till they're age 26. It 150 million Americans, including every American on employer insurance, is guaranteed access at no cost to preventative health services. That's free vaccines. That's contraception. That's cancer screening. That's mental health screening. Those, and so one of these lawsuits, we start there, is from the brought, it's a idea that came from the same lawyer who wrote the anti-abortion bill in Texas. It's supported by Stephen Miller, probably one of the worst actors in the Trump administration, and a lot of the money for it comes from the U lines.
Oh yeah, we're familiar.
you're very familiar with them, mm-hmm. And so they're in court. Then they forum shop the judge, find, you know, the same judge who ruled that the ACA was unconstitutional just a few years ago and got overturned by the Supreme Court, including all of Trump's existing appointments. Mm-hmm. And they're behind this. So who wakes up in the morning in America? What kind of person wakes up and says, my goal in life is to take away free cancer screenings, mental health screenings from 150 million Americans? Like, where does that make any sense? But they're at it.
They're at it, and it'll be, what, before the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals in, what, just a matter of weeks here?
Yeah, and, you know, we lost, obviously, at the district court. The quote-unquote plaintiffs are there trying to make it even worse at the, you know, at the appellate court. So these are all very, very, very real threats. So that's, you know, that's really, that is out there. It'll go to the Supreme Court, and as we all know, that's exactly the plan. So, you know, but we're, you know, we're working hard because I think it's just very important that the court, frankly, understands that people are going to be pissed off about this. I'm a big believer that the court does care about its reputation. Doesn't mean it will do the right thing, but, you know, hurting 150 million Americans is a big deal.
It is, but you know what else is a big deal is coming at the attacks on healthcare and on women's healthcare rights in a way that is so radical that in talking about this second court case, the second legal threat, in a way that would basically blow up the entire way that the Food and Drug Administration goes through the drug approval process just to attack mifepristone, which is, you know, vital in, you know, women's reproductive care, abortion care. That case is still hanging out there, right?
Very much so. And that's probably, you know, given the recent history of this court on abortion, you know, might be the most problematic one out there if you were just calling the shot. I mean, the likelihood. And what this is about is that there are all sorts of reasons why this decision in the low, again, a forum shop, single judge, total abortion advocate who should have anti-abortion advocate who should have recused himself from this, tore down mifepristone and the ability for people to get that. You put that on top of the physical restrictions on abortions, and you understand why, you know, the issue is so doubly dire. And, you know, they are, and one of the things that, you know, that we're particularly focused on, because it wasn't, you know, as much attention being paid to it, was that this, exactly as you said, is going to wreak havoc in the entire drug approval system. Because here we have some lone judge somewhere overriding the decision of the FDA about the safety of America's drugs. So what's going to happen next? You know, think of all the politically motivated judges out there and politically motivated lawyers out there. You know, Stephen Miller is going to rack up five more of these mRNA vaccines. They're going to go after any drug that has been developed using fetal tissue. They, you know, so this is a nightmare for the drug companies, but more importantly, for those of us who depend and trust on this regulatory system.
And again, we'll watch that at the U.S. Supreme Court. And then finally, again, one of those things, who wakes up in the morning and says, let's get rid of Medicare's ability to negotiate better prices for America's seniors? And yet that's a court case that's coming up yet this month in January.
Yeah, nine of them. And we expect, you know, there'll be more. So, of course, in this case, we do know who and why wakes up in the morning, because it's the big drug companies who and their CEOs who think that, you know, making tens of millions of dollars a year is not enough, and who think that being the most profitable business in America is not enough greed for them. So they, you know, want to continue charging Americans four times what they charge anybody in any other country for the same drug. This is a question of, it's just about greed and about making Americans pay a price no one else in the world pays. And, you know, it's one of the things about all of this, and you know this, Pat, is that, you know, there are a lot of partisan issues in America. Healthcare is not a partisan issue. This has, Medicare negotiations has 85% approval with the American public. It's Democrats, Republicans, rural Americans, urban Americans, people who live in coal country, people who live in wind country. It is the only place that healthcare is partisan is in legislatures, in the Wisconsin legislature when it comes to Medicaid, in the Congress of the United States when it comes to everything else having to do with healthcare. That's the only place it's partisan.
And by the way, this would be an honest debate if it were an actual debate, if there were a Republican replacement plan. If Donald Trump, who said that he's going to come out with this big, beautiful plan, had ever come out with a big, beautiful plan. But last I checked, there's still no actual Republican plan where they say, we have a better way. It's just a matter of what? They couldn't get it. They couldn't rip it away in Congress or the legislature. So they're trying to rip it away in court.
Yeah, that's exactly it. But don't assume they've given up on getting rid of it. I mean, unfortunately, in all of our nightmares, if they do wake up or the country wakes up and they're in charge, you know damn well that they're going to go out for this law. And actually, I think this narrative that they might have an alternative is far more dangerous than just repeal in a way, because, you know, the very few Americans really know all the parts of the bill. They don't know that necessarily that pre-existing conditions is dependent on the Affordable Care Act. They don't know preventive services, even if they're in their employer's plan, is due to the Affordable Care Act. Kids to 26, due to the Affordable Care Act. But the $1 million cap on lifetime benefits, which if you have a sick kid in the neonatal unit, you'll use up in 2 weeks, is due to the Affordable Care Act.
We've been saying this for over a decade. As people learn what's in it, then they like it, but they get caught up in the political games that are played. And if they don't pay attention to conversations like this, it's only going to threaten their own health care in the future. And hey, Joe, I hope you get better soon, but thanks for lending us Leslie Dock for a week, board chair of Protect Our Care. We've learned so much in a short time. I hope we get to visit again soon. Thanks for pinch hitting and Happy New Year to you.
It was fun and Happy New Year to you.
It's weird to think that Joe Sopecki might play the Wally Pip to Leslie Dock's, Lou Gehrig. Maybe. I think Joe's in good shape here. We'll have today's history lesson and some musical memories coming up next. You're up north. It's a kind of behind the scenes look here. This is how Luke and I tend to start our day. We just, look at each other and say, good morning, gorgeous.
I have a picture of Pat Kreitlow right next to my bedroom mirror, and I say good morning to both of us every morning.
Yeah. But here's the thing. Who played the song for us first? Dr. Lyerly. So, of course, now today is the 53rd birthday of Mary J. Blige. So we've got a reason to play the song, and she's not even around to hear the chorus. Until now. Now she pops in.
The roads are bad. I had to take my son to school, and the roads are bad. We've got, snow. Today should have been our snow day.
And Luke was behind a snow plow for a big chunk of his morning commute as well. So
I was surprised when I woke up this morning. We've got almost 2 inches out there.
Not the fun snow. Snow earlier this week, it was the night, it's easier to drive in because it was wet snow and it was a good compact, snowball snow. This is the light, dusty stuff that just makes everything slick and it obstructs your view while you're driving. This is the not fun snow. I would have preferred to drive in the other snow, honestly.
And it's really stuck to the pavement because it was warm yesterday, so it all melted and then it snowed. And it's going to be, we're going to have white roads for a while, I think.
It's no more of that. Have the asphalt driveway, that faces south. So you think the sun is going to do the work, but there's always that point where it goes, nope, not anymore. This is what you're going to get. How's your week gone?
Good.
All right.
Yeah.
Good.
Busy.
I know you've got a new segment starting us off. It's 7:30 with more women who are going to win in Wisconsin in 2024. And talk about the glamorous side of politics with Emily Cephos.
The glamorous side of politics. Come on, Pat. You know better than that.
When you're shooting your social media thing in a driving snowstorm, which is what she put up yesterday or the day before, it'll be fun to talk to her about that. But
Can I just give a shout out to my second son who just brought me a cup of coffee?
Were you running that far behind this morning?
Yes. Wow. I didn't even ask for it. That's how amazing my kids are. Mm.
Mm-hmm. That is very nice. So as mentioned, Mary J. Blige turns 53 today. This is also, she shares a birthday with Alexander Hamilton, who was such a talented first Secretary of the Treasury that he wrote a song about himself. Just you wait. Okay, I got to come clean. Alexander Hamilton did not write that. He didn't write the play about himself. But I will look for any excuse to play part of the soundtrack because it's just so good.
I've never listened to
on the.
How have you still not done that yet?
Waiting for my third son, my musical theater kid. I wanted to do that with him.
Yes.
He's just not there.
Make that happen.
It's so good. It's so good. And this is now, I also did your first back in 2024 show, and we did What Did I Miss? So this is two for two for me playing Hamilton for you, Pat.
That's right. See, I got to find, now I got to find reasons to drop in every track, you know, off of the soundtrack. Let's see. So he was born this day in 1755. This one's a little bit more bittersweet. Clarence Clemens, sax player for Bruce Springsteen. He was born this day in 1942. Here's his tune with Jackson Browne. Clarence Clemens passed away in 2011.
I don't know if people realize how important Clarence Clemens was to Bruce Springsteen. Like, it was their chemistry, really, that helped to skyrocket the live presence.
So much so, yes. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's still so missed all these years later. The Grand Canyon National Monument was created this day in 1908. Talk about women and achievement. Amelia Earhart became the first person to fly solo from Hawaii to California. Yay. On this day in 1935. On this day in 1972, East Pakistan didn't want to be called East Pakistan anymore and renamed itself Bangladesh. Born this day in 1887, Aldo Leopold, the ecologist and author, and wrote Sand County Almanac, passed away in 1948.
Wisconsin heavy history there.
Yes, very good, very good book. Naomi Judd, whom we lost in 2022, she was born this day in 1946.
Lovers really fall in love to stay, stand beside each other.
Also born this day, Tony Kaye is 78 years old today, a founding member and keyboard player of the supergroup Yes. We played a little bit from Lee Ritenour earlier. He turned 72 today. Vicki Peterson, lead guitarist for the Bangles, is 66 years old today. One of the Bangles is 66.
Yeah, but where's the Bangles music? Let's bust some of that out.
It's coming. We played some 25 minutes ago.
Somebody
had you been
wasn't
here
listening when she was taking her kid to school?
I know. You know, you can feed the Civic Media app right through the Bluetooth in your fancy car there. And you can.
I forgot
take
my
the road.
Phone. I
you
know.
Forgot your phone
That's
too.
A heck of a morning that you're having, Dr. Wow. Riley.
I needed the coffee. Yes.
No kidding. Wow. A couple of health notes. One is really unfortunate, but it was 4 years ago today now, this day in 2020, that health officials in Wuhan announced the first recorded death from COVID-19. And we all know where it went from there. But also this one, Dr. Lyerly, it was on this day in 1964. The Surgeon General at the time, Dr. Luther Terry, published a landmark report about the health hazards of smoking. And again, I always end up sounding, you know, naive or whatever the case may be, because goodness knows there's plenty of other, you know, unhealthy behaviors that we can all engage in. But I honestly always think back to that 1964 Surgeon General report, the warnings on every pack of cigarettes. And I still, sometimes I'm just flabbergasted when I see him, like, how are you still smoking when you know what it does in this day and age? He said, taking a drink of what is clearly not an old-fashioned.
A little coffee has actually been shown to benefit your health. A little coffee. Mm-hmm. A lot of coffee, not so much.
I think what Pat was alluding to was that maybe it's not coffee in the cup.
I have my vices, but, you know, smoking has just never been one of them because I'm like, We're supposed to be breathing clean air. Why would I inhale smoke or
Seems
something?
Seems like a bad idea to set chemicals into your lungs.
It does, doesn't it? So, again.
But it's cool.
So some people say, you know. So, again, that came out this day in 1964, so 60 years ago. 60 years we have had documented proof of the health hazards of cigarettes. Let's see. Today is International Thank You Day, so get those notes written for your Christmas gifts. It's National Hot Toddy Day.
Which, that's what's in your mug.
Yeah, that should be. That would help my throat, that for sure. It's National Milk Day, and it's National Girl Hug Boy Day. Which, it's supposed to be like, it's supposed to be a hug day. Like, anybody should be able to hug anybody, but they made it girl hug boy. Let's respect those boundaries, kids. Respect those boundaries. More with Kristen Lyerly and more in our next hour on Up North News Radio. Back in just a bit.